Hi everyone, thank you. My talk will be about GoLinters. For those who are experienced in GoLinters, they will benefit from learning advanced techniques, and beginners in linters will be able to start using linters right after the talk. Let's begin. I am the creator of GoLinksiaLint, it's the open source linters runner, and my talk is based on my own experiences of introducing linters into the two largest internet companies in Russia, and my experience of communicating with hundreds of GoLinksiaLint users. I understand a lot of problems that linters users typically face. Also, I'm a senior engineering manager in Yandex in ride-hailing department, also known as Yango. First, please raise your hands who have used linters in Go. Oh, okay, that's good. Almost everyone. I will be short. If we have some example program with an issue on 7th line, we have a formatting error %d instead of %s. If we run it, we see that it was printed improperly, incorrect. And we can run this source code on GoVet. It's a linter, default linter in Go, and it outputs, it warns about this issue. And I define a linter as a program that gets source code as input and outputs found issues in it. Let's go. We'll talk about five myths, and the first one is the most popular one, that linters can't find real bugs in our programs. I would like to show you three counterexamples in popular open source Go projects that demonstrate that linters can find bugs. The first one is in project etcd. Go critic linter found swapped strings has prefix arguments, as you see on the slides, and therefore unsafe protocol HTTP checks didn't work. Luckily, Go critic found it. The next one is in Docker project. Cancellation of context function wasn't called in one of error branches, and because of that, for example, background goroutines wasn't finished early, and GoVet linter found it also. And the last one is in Go language itself, in Go language source code. We see that the variable is compared with itself, and it's just a typical copy-paste error, and Go critic found it. So, just three counterexamples that I easily found in 30 minutes that linters can find real bugs. I think myth is busted. Let's go further. The second myth is some guys can say, okay, linters can find real bugs. Okay, that's good. But are you sure that linters do more harm than good? I would like to say that the primary benefit of linters is the development cost reduction. If you find your bugs early, for example, if you run linters locally after you wrote your code, we can say you have found it in coding stage, and it will cost the company much less money than if you find it in production. But one can say, okay, that's good, linters can be helpful, but what if I run linters, I will get around 80% of false positives. How can I use linters with such distribution? And such distribution can really be true in, for example, if you run linters first time in your experience for a large project with millions of lines of code. But if you configure linters properly, I will show later how to do it. From my experience, distribution will be like this on the slide. It's like 5% of false positives and around 10% of bugs. Also, linters allow to speed up code reviews. From my experience as engineering manager, I often see in my teams that people tend to comment on issues in GitHub that can be easily found by linters. They waste their time doing it, and we have a code review agreement in our teams that we don't comment, we don't look for such issues that can be easily found by linters, and we are sure that even if a developer forgot to run linters locally, the CI build will be failed because we run linters in our CI. And Also, another benefit of using Litres is that I can ensure code quality in my projects. I can guarantee that, for example, there will be no unused variables, long functions, bad namings of identificators, and so on. And it's also a good benefit. It's a very subjective thing, I know. And but I prefer to set the strongest settings for such linters and to enable almost all style linters. And just to sum up, linters can find bugs, they catch bugs early, and also they can speed up code reviews and manage code quality in your projects. And I think this myth is busted. Let's go to the next myth. Go has a lot of linters. It's a unique language. It's, I think, the best language if we talk about tooling, linters, and so on. And there are too many linters. And people say, oh, it's too much linters, 50 linters, 100 linters, so which ones should I use? And there is an opinion that we should use only two or three linters. And the most common way to use linters in open source projects is to use some subset of linters that you see on the slide. It's GoViet, ErrorCheck, GoLint. They are the most popular linters, and they are really cool. I would like to introduce 25 linters in 10 minutes and to show you that there are much more than three linters that can be useful for you. Let's start from the first group of linters. It's formatting checking linters. Let's start from GoFMT. GoFMT is a tool that allows you to format your code. It's not a linter, but we can use it as a linter. And for example, it can detect missing new lines, so I can this example, it can warn about extra or missing spaces. And also, there is a less known option, minus S, to simplify code. And here it says us, you don't need a len X, you just can omit it. It's super flawless. Also, there is a Go imports. It's a superset of GoFMT. It can do everything that GoFMT can. And also, additionally, it performs some imports checking. For example, here it says it would be cool if we reorder our imports for them to become in alphabetical order. Another one, linter, is unindent. Here it says us that we can replace two conditions with one, and it will help us to reduce code indentation level of log printing line, as you can see here. It's also useful for indentation level reduction. Okay, we have talked about formatting checking linters, and I think they are must-have for any project, just because to ensure consistent code formatting across your projects, across your code. And let's talk about complexity checking. The first linter is GoCycle. It detects two complex functions. Complexity is measured by cyclomatic complexity. Cyclomatic complexity is, roughly speaking, is a number of if conditions inside your function. And as you can see here, it's a really complex function. It's difficult to understand even if it has 10 lines of code. And GoCycle has some threshold of cyclomatic complexity. You can think about it as amount of conditions in your function. And if amount of conditions in your function is bigger than specified, it will warn about this function. And also, I should note that it's the most hated linter in my experience, and developers in my teams all always want to increase this threshold, and there is always pressure from both sides about this threshold. Another one is NakedRed. This linter reports about returns in functions, in long functions, without explicit return values. These returns are called naked returns, and there is some agreement that it's a bad style, that's bad because code reader need to scroll up to function definition to find out what are return values, how they are defined, and so on. And NakedRed reports about such returns. Okay, we have discussed complexity checking linters. Let's go to style checking. The first linter is GoCheckNoGlobals. It detects global variables in your code And also there is a known site, go check now init's, similar linter it detects init functions. The both of linters are about the same thing, that we shouldn't have a global state in our programs, and we should avoid them whenever possible. GoLint is a super useful style linter. It's from a Go team, thank you them, and it ensures that Go conventions are okay. For example, here it says that URL is initialism and it should be written in uppercase, not like just one letter uppercase. GoSimple is a part of static check, previously known as mega check, and it has a lot, dozens or maybe hundreds of checks how to simplify our code. Here it says us that string has prefix is superfluous, we don't need it really, and it's because string prefix already has only the checks, it performs checks like has prefix inside, so we can just remove this check. GoConst is a linter that finds all string literals or number literals that are repeated in our code, and it says us that we can move it to constant to remove duplication in our code. And here it reports warnings about HTTP string. We can specify threshold or for amount of duplicates. Here I have set it to two string literal repetitions. Misspell linter detects grammatical errors in English in different dialects of English. In our code, it can detect misspellings in, for example, comment strings, in identifier names, and so on. And here it reports about else misspelling, else word. Unconvert is another useful linter. It says that we do unnecessary conversion of variable u to type string because it already of type string, and we don't need to do this conversion. Okay, we have discussed style checking. Let's talk about unused code checking linters. Varchek linter detects unused variable in our code. Unused linter finds unused struct fields in our structs. Dead code can find unused types, unused functions, and so on. Unparam. Unparam is the linter that can detect unused function arguments, but it's not as simple as you may think, because sometimes we need to ensure the function interface, for example, to match each some external interface, and we need to use specified arguments. And Unparam is smart enough to detect such situations, and it doesn't have false positives if we do a function to match some interface. It's a really cool linter. But it's slow. One may say that, okay, these unused linters are cool, but unused code is not harmful. What if we had unused code? It's okay, it doesn't harm anyone. But sometimes unused code can lead to real bugs. In my experience in FSign, the linter that can show us such bugs. For example, here it shows that we don't use the result of counter increment after we changed this variable. So it reports about ineffectual assignments when we don't use the result of our assignments. I strongly recommend using it. We have talked about unused code linters. Let's talk about performance linters. Sometimes structs have gaps between their fields just for alignment. Because of different sizes of different types. And maligned is the linter that reports such fields that can be reduced in memory if we reorder our fields. Just it will be more efficient. If you use a maligned from Go and Xialint, it will also report to you the final layout, how to reorder them. GoCritic is the collection of checks. It has dozens or maybe hundreds of checks, and one of them is hugeparam. Hugeparam reports where we shouldn't copy a heavy large type by value, and we should pass it by pointer. Here you can see that variable age of type heavy should be is copied when passed to argument, and we can use pointer if we would like to save CPU on copying. And there are some situations in our code where we can pre-allocate our slices. For example, when we know their final size, like here, we know that we iterate over SS slice, and we can just pre-allocate red variable by length of FS. And pre-alloc linter can find such places in our code and report them. So we talk about performance linters, but I would like to warn you that such linters can lead to pre-match optimization. I have seen it really often in my experience, and because of that, I usually just disable all performance linters. Let's talk about bug finding. It's my favorite category of bugs, of linter issues, of linters, because they really show benefit of using linters. The first one is scope lint. It can detect the most common, maybe, issue of Go developer newbies. It shows when we reference for range scope variables, because range scope variables can point to another variable if we go to the next loop iteration, and we should avoid such constructs. Static check is a super useful linter. You should definitely use it. It has dozens, hundreds of checks. A lot of them are about real bugs, so race conditions, crashes, and so on. Here it says that we have race condition. We increment sync by group inside Go routine, but we definitely should do it before entry Go routine. Just use it. Go vet is also very bug intensive linter in the default Go distribution. Here it says that condition has definitely a bug, because it's always true. And GoSec is the security-oriented linter. It can detect possible security vulnerabilities. For example, here it finds possible shell injection if ARC is passed from user, for example. And in my experience, GoSec has some amount of false positive and should be configured correctly to use it. Error check. Is the last one in linters. It detects situations where we missed error checking. Obviously, it should be avoided. I have showed two issues from GoCritic and static check, per one linter, but I should say that these linters have hundreds maybe of checks, and it's definitely worth it to learn these linters, to learn their checks. And also, there is a revive linter. It's positioned as a drop-in replacement for GoLint. Also, it's positioned as 6 times faster than GoLint and has a few additional checks. We have discussed 25 linters. I have shown, by example, how they can be useful, and I think the myth is busted. If you would like to see a complete list of linters, you can follow this link. And you may ask me, okay, it's cool, 25 linters, 50 linters at all, but which ones should I use? And I can say that you may enable all linters in the beginning and then just start disabling them one by one. From my experience, it will take you no more than 1-2 hours, but you will create your own personal set of linters that you think are not false positive and are useful for you, and just use them later for your projects. Let's go to the fourth myth about linters, that running linters is too slow. And really, just maybe 1 year ago, it was true. The typical make file for running linters is like that. We're just doing go get of, for example, 4 popular linters, and then we sequentially run them one by one. The problem with such code is that we need 10 lines of code for just running 4 linters. What, for example, if we need 10 linters, 20, 40, makefile will be too large. And another problem is that we run them sequentially, and it's really too slow. We can take minutes to execute. We can do it better a bit if we use XArcs. XArcs is a shell tool to perform some actions, for example, to do a parallel run. Here we can run in 4 threads, and it could be a bit faster. But it almost still has a problem of too many code to run 4 linters. Please raise your hand who have used Go MetaLinter. Okay, not all, thank you. Go MetaLinter is an open source linters runner. It aggregates all linters in once and allows you to run linters just by one line, like you see in slide, and it allows you to install them at once by one command. It's very convenient, useful, and also it does parallel run just much more efficient than with XArc or sequentially. Let's discuss what does a typical linter do. Typically, it spends around 80% of time on code parsing, code loading, and so on, and just 20% of time for actual analyzing. And it performs just for all linters, so we duplicate around 80% of our work. What if we can just parse and load our code once and analyze it by each linter? It will be dramatically faster than our current approach, which is used by Go MetaLinter, XArc Sequential, and so on. And luckily, there is a Go NXLint, which already does it. It analyzes code only once. Sorry, parses and loads code only once. And then it performs analysis by all linters, as you see here, only for a small part of time. And I am the creator of Go NXLint. And also, it aggregates like a Go MetaLinter all linters at once. You don't need to install them separately. Their versions are fixed and so on. And you can replace the whole makefile by just this one line of code. It's very simple. And I have run on my small project all these approaches, and you can see that sequential linters running was very slow. We can speed up it a bit by XArc. Go MetaLinter was a little faster, and Go NXLint is super fast, just because it performs parsing and loading only once. I should say that Go MetaLinter was deprecated in favor of Go NXLint. And therefore, in the rest of the talk, we will discuss only Go NXLint. Even if you think that Go NXLint runtime is too slow for you, we have an option -- fast, which runs only fast linters. And we consider only 3 linters as slow: static check, interfacer, and unparam. Go NXLint uses Go packages library for code loading and parsing, and this library uses build cache. Build cache allows us to speed up all consequent runs. You can see it on the slide. If we clean our cache, the first run will be very slow, but another runs will be really faster. And because of that, I recommend reuse your build cache between UCI builds. For example, it's a configuration for Travis CI. How to save and restore your build cache. Okay, I think the myth about speed was busted. In my experience, if you use Go NXLint, your linters will be running maybe 1 or maximum 2 minutes. Just use Go NXLint. Let's go to the last myth about introducing linters into your projects. The common problem is that it's too late to introduce linters into your project because, for example, you have millions of lines of code, you run just one linter, Go lint, and you see hundreds, thousands of linter issues. And we can't just integrate Go lint because CI will be failed already. We need to reduce all issues count to zero to be able to integrate any linter into our CI process. The first thing we can do is to use Go NXLint. It has already default exclude list. For example, issues about missing comments for exported identifiers are considered as false positives. I know it's a disputable topic, it's just because a lot of developers think that it's a false positive. If you use Go NXLint, you will get not thousands but hundreds of issues by default on your million lines of code project. Okay, we have hundreds of issues. Next, let's do some configuration of GoLangCLint. We have .golangci.yaml file, and we can exclude issues by their text, by their type. We can do it with the help of regular expressions. For example, issues exclude. If we don't like weak cryptographic issues from GoSec, we say that we should exclude such issues. Okay. If you need more fine-grained excluded, you can use new exclude rules directive to specify for which linters you would like to exclude them. Sometimes you need to exclude all issues from, for example, your third-party directory when you can't control your code in this directory, or from some files, for example, generated protobuf files and so on. And you can also specify such files and directories in our configuration. And in the same way, we have exclude rules for more fine-grained configuration. But sometimes, even if we excluded all kinds of issues by such configuration, we still have maybe 10 or 20 of issues which are not false positives at all, but in such concrete specific situations, they are false positives, and we need to exclude them one by one only in these specific lines. And we can do it by using common directive nolint. It can be specified with some concrete linters or without linters at all, to exclude just all linters. If we use it at the end of the line, it will exclude all issues from this line. If we use it at the beginning of the line, it will exclude all issues for coming block of code. It's for function on the slide example, as you see. And one can say, okay, it's cool. We can spend 2 hours to exclude all issues by configuration, but I have dozens of projects. I don't have so many time. Can I do it just zero configuration, just magic button to enable linters in my project? And there is such a way, it exists. Let's start from example. Just imagine we have a program main Go with one issue on the fifth line of code about printf formatting error. And we run Go with it, we see this issue. Okay. And I should say that this issue is already in Origin Master and was added, for example, 1 year ago. Now let's run it forward by RevGrep2. We specify origin master as an argument, and RevGrep2 filters out all issues that were added before specified git revision, origin master in our example. And if a previous issue was added before origin master, it won't be outputted. So we have no issues. It looks like what we want. We actually would like to see only new issues to perform zero configuration introduction of linters into our project. Okay, let's add a new code, sixth line, with another issue. Let's run go with it. We see our second issue on the sixth line, and let's run RevGrep again. And we see the magic. We see that only new issue was shown. We don't see old issue, so I can say that we really can just take our project, just fix current git hash revision in our master, pass it to RevGrep, and to say, okay guys, in my team, now we will try to remove all new issues. All new issues are disallowed, but all existing issues are okay. We will fix them later, and RevGrep does it. And also, GoLangCLint already integrates RevGrep into its binary. You don't need to install RevGrep separately. Just use option minus minus new from rev and set specified git revision. The best way is specify current origin master commit SSA. And that's all about this integration. So we have talked about two ways to integrate linters into any project. The first one is to exclude linters issues one by one or one kind and so on, and it might take 1-2 hours for your project. But there is a way also to do it in 5 minutes with zero configuration with the help of minus minus new from rev option. The math is busted. Now let's go to best practices, the last topic I would like to discuss. We have talked that GoLangCLint has configuration. You can see all configuration options here by following the link on the slide. They are described here. And this configuration has a lot of useful things. For example, just imagine, what if we would like to separate our imports of from local project, for example, github.com my repo, from all external imports. What if I just like such kind of formatting? And we can do it with the help of Go imports local prefixes settings in Golang's YAML configuration file. We just set our local prefix, as you see on slides, to github.com my repo, and after that, Go and Xlint, if you run Go imports linter, will warn about such lines where these imports are not separated. And moreover, you can use --- fix, it's a recently added option to Go and Xlint, to automatically fix found issues, but it works for not all linters, only for misspell Go imports and Go FMT, as I remember. Let's talk about installation of Go and Xlint. Typically, there are three ways to do it. The first one is to perform just raw Go get. The second one is to perform Go get with specified version. And the last one is to do curl of binary release. The first one is bad. Just because you don't know your version, at one moment, Go and Xlint version will be updated and you get a new release with new linters, with new checks inside existing linters, and so on, and UCI builds will be failed at one moment. It will be better if you just use GoGet with a specified version. You guarantee that UCI build won't be failed at one moment. And the best way is to use binary releases, because binary releases are guaranteed, are tested, and just are installed much faster than GoGetting. Let's talk about when we should run linters. I recommend running linters in git pre-commit hooks. Please raise your hand who knows what are git pre-commit hooks. Okay, git pre-commit hooks are shell scripts which are run when you type git commit or just do git commit and just before the moment when git commit finishes. So if we would like to run linters in our pre-commit hook. If linters will fail, they will find some issues, your commit will be aborted. So it allows you to guarantee that not linted code, code with issues, won't be pushed to your Git repository. It just can speed up your development cycle to not find issues in your CI builds, but find them locally. And you can configure it by a simple pre-commit tool. It's very convenient, useful, and much easier than to configure it manually. And Go and Xlint already integrated with this tool, just an example of such configuration. Also, I recommend using linters with your code editors. Almost all popular code editors are integrated with, for example, Go and Xlint, and just find issues during live coding, it allows you to reduce the development cycle even more. Typically, users run linters in CI. It's very good. If you don't run linters in CI, you can guarantee that linters will be run, that developer won't forget about it. But there is a way to do it much better. In a classic case, when you run linters in UCI, if, for example, CI build fails, you need to go to build log to find out what happened, go through thousands of lines of some issues, some debug logs, and so on and so on. And then even if you find that some linter failed, you need to find out which file, go to code editor, find in the file, find in the line, and so on. It can take 1 or 2 minutes. What if linters could comment on issues like a typical human reviewer on GitHub? It will be much more convenient. You don't need to go to your code editor to view a context. And much better, what if some linters could suggest you changes in GitHub and you can execute apply such changes just in one click? It will be very cool, and such tools exist. For example, if you'd like to use them self-hosted, you can use ReviewDoc, free open source tool for doing it, or you can use cloud solutions, for example, golangci.com, codeclimate.com, and so on. Typically, cloud solutions are free if you use open source GitHub repositories. Also, I would like to show you Go report card. It's a cool site which runs linters, a few linters, and shows issue from running them. And I like it because it has some game mechanics. It allows you to see a page with your score, A+, for example, and it motivates you to improve your code quality if you have some issues. It's a really cool thing, I think. Sometimes we need to write our own linters. For example, if we have some corporate policy and there are no just open source linters for some check. And if you do it, I strongly recommend you using Go Analysis. It's a new framework from Go team. It allows you to not write hundreds of lines of boilerplate code. It's a really cool thing. Just use it if you would like to write your own linter. And the primary benefit, maybe it's that it allows you to easily integrate with GoVet, GoLangCLint, and so on, because it's a common unified interface for writing new linters. And just to sum up what we have discussed today, first we have talked about why linters are useful. I have shown you 25 linters by examples. We have talked with to use, we have talked about linter performance, that if you use Go and Xialint, you can run linters really fast. And we have talked about two ways how to introduce linters into any project, just in 1 hour or 5 minutes, so like you want. And we have talked about best practices. I have some recipes what to do tomorrow if you'd like to apply in practice this knowledge. If you don't use Go and Xialint yet, you can introduce it. You know how in just 5 minutes, for example, with minus minus new from ref for easy integration. If you already use Go and Xialint, you can use CI integration. I enable it in your code editor, pre-commit hook, and so on. And I strongly recommend you for using ReviewDog, GoLangCI.com, and so on, integrations just for linters to become like human code reviewers. And you can find slides by this link. My contacts are here. Thank you for listening. And if you have questions, you can ask me them in the hallway after the talk. Thank you.